A very good morning to one and all present here. This is Neha, MC for the day. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to Dr. Mrs. Kausalya Murthy and Justice M.N. Murthy Endowment Lecture conducted by the Department of Bank Management. I request Mrs. Praveena Ma'am, Assistant Professor, Department of Bank Management, to give the welcome address.
Leadership is the capacity to translate vision into reality. Good morning to one and all present here. I welcome you all to Dr. Mrs. Kausalya Murthy and Justice M.N. Murthy's Endowment Lecture. I welcome our distinguished speaker of the day, Ms. Hema Mani, Dr. Mrs. H.S. Kodai, Principal and Secretary, Ithraj College for Women, Dr. Mrs. D.B. Usha Rani, Vice Principal Aider, Dr. Mrs. T. Usha Priya, Vice Principal, Self Supporting Stream, and Head of the PG Department of Banking and Insurance Management and Department of Bank Management. It is said that great leaders do not set out to be a leader, they set out to make a difference. With that being said, we have amongst us one such great leader, Ms. Hema Mani, Director, HR for India and APEC Lennox International. Hema Mani has over 25 years of experience in strategic human resource capacity with wide-ranging multinational experiences from Cayley Consultants, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Jain Group of Institutions, I2 Technologies, and Honeywell. She is a certified Korn Ferry Leadership Architect and Coach, Lean Sigma Green Belt Assessor, and a certified OD Facilitator. She is currently heading the Asian Pacific HR at Lennox International, a part of her responsibility in Lennox India and the Asian Sourcing Leadership Team. She spends considerably time in focusing on talent development in these regions and developing them into a global team of excellence. She is committed to the cause of diversity. She has recently launched the LGBTQ+ initiative at Lennox India. Under her leadership, Lennox India has won several honors for HR, such as the 13th Best Workplace in Tamil Nadu by Times of India, 100 Best Places to Work for Women in India 2016 by Avata, Best Places to Work in Chennai by Economic Times, the Best Games-Based Learning Program by TISS, and the Dream Companies to Work in 2016 by Times Ascent. Best Community Engagement Award by Economic Times. More recently, Lennox was certified as the top 100 great places to work under her leadership. She is the current chairwoman for CII Indian Women Network in Chennai, and focuses on developing leadership talent in women, mentoring, gender parity diagnostic, facilitation in corporations, and POSH activities. She was one of the founding members of Mahavir Academy of Technology and Science, part of the Jain group of institution. Here, she was responsible for developing the HR curriculum for postgraduate students in collaboration with industry and academic experts. As a member of the board of XIME Chennai, she plays a vital role in developing the HR curriculum for the group. As part of XIME, she also mentors and coaches young HR talent. She has published papers on execution excellence in HR, which was compiled into a journal and released by Indian Institute of Science, and another one on innovative learning strategies was appreciated by NASSCOM. She is recognized as one of the 30th women super achiever by World HRD Congress. On behalf of the staff and students of the Department of Bank Management, we extend a warm welcome to you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. I now request the chief guest and speaker of the day, Mrs. Hema Mani, Director, HR for India, APAC Lennox International, to take through an insightful session on the topic Leadership in Uncertain Times. Over to you, ma'am.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Neha, and thank you, Dr. Praveena, for that warm introduction. Thanks for also accommodating and being flexible. I know I had committed to this talk on Friday, unfortunately landed up with a neck sprain so bad that I couldn't even get off. It was a terrible day for me. But I'm glad. Thank you to all for being flexible and making way for the session on a Monday morning. I don't know how keen students are for a lecture first thing on a Monday morning, but we'll see how to make this as interesting and as interactive. I think beyond a lecture, what I would really like is to keep the chat going on and keep posting your questions as you know, we keep going through the whole session. I'm hoping that the students can put in their comments and their questions on the chat window. Is that a possibility? Because I'm using this for the first time. All right, so let's go ahead. I hope all of you also are having your mobile phones handy along with your computers or your desktops or your laptops, because I'm going to run some polls for which you will need to use your mobile phone, or you can also do it through your laptop, right? So just to make it a little more interactive and make sure that you're participating while we are going through it. And that's what I'd like to say. Leadership is more about participation than about the individual themselves, right? And I would like this session to be more participative, more interactive. You know, Praveena had asked me what is the topic I would like to speak about. Well, for the last 25 years, I have been a HR professional and a leader at that. For the last 10 years, I have been heading a region in the engineering space and leading teams through not just one crisis, but in my own tenure, I probably went through three major crises. Some of you may not even have been born at that time. Unfortunately, we had the World Trade Center that came down in the late 1990s. That was the very first crisis as a professional and as a leader I went through, and I observed the way other senior leaders in the organization handled and some of the learnings coming out through that. And then subsequently, around early 2000, we had the major financial crisis that hit the world market with the Wall Street in New York crumbling. And since many of you are banking students, I'm assuming you probably did some studies around the banking crisis that hit in the early 2000. That was a big setback. That was also the time I had just joined a new organization with a promise that I will build it up and set it up. And we were just about 20 people in the organization when the crisis really loomed large, and we had some very tough decisions to make. And then, of course, now with this whole pandemic since the last year. The crisis is not still over as yet, but how are we handling ourselves? So when Praveena asked me, what is the topic you would like to speak about? I felt most comfortable to talk about my experiences. I am more a storyteller. I relate more by my own experiences than what I see from books and papers. Although I'm an avid book reader, I read a lot of books, and that is something I would encourage students to do also as you pursue your careers, be it in academia or otherwise, to be really close to books, because the amount that literature, books teach us, nothing else touches. And I have experimented with possibly everything. Nothing else teaches us as much as, you know, the written literature does. So I did borrow a few slides from here and there, but that is more so to give me a structure to what I'm going to speak and what I'm going to share with all of you. And to begin with, you know, this is a nice quote I really liked. What leaders need during a crisis is not a predefined response plan, but behaviors and mindsets that will prevent them from overreacting to yesterday's developments and help them look ahead. So what does this really mean, right? All of you today who are students will become tomorrow's leaders in some form, right? And leaders does not mean just that you need to have a group of people under you. Right? It can be just a self-leader. You're a leader in your own process or in your own function. So what you really require as a leader is not, you know, I don't anticipate any of my team members to come with a predefined plan. Okay, this is how we are going to deal with COVID crisis, or this is how we are going to deal with the financial crisis, because none of us have answers to that, because it's as unpredicted for everybody, including the leader, as much as with the team as well. Let me put my phone off a bit so that we are not disturbed. So it's unpredictable, it's undefined. Nobody knows what happens, how does it happen, what transpires, right? It's like a tragedy that hits you, that comes into you, and you really don't know how to react, whether it is flight, fight, or what is the response you're giving. But what a leader really can do is work on behaviors and mindsets. And that is something continuously I would encourage each one of you to look at. How are you preparing yourself for the worst? You know, they say the diamond only shines when it is cut, right? And, you know, I was also reading another piece of, you know, a friend of mine who was telling me that the finest leaders are the ones who come through various crisis situations, various troubled situations, because the leadership, you know, gets hit on the road, it gets measured, it gets impacted, and what comes out of it is a much better individual. So I, for one, having gone through three crises in my own career, actually four in a way, because right when I began my career in 1995 was the first time there was a economic bubble burst. And we were just out of college with a very fancy degree in our hands and no jobs. You know, we had no jobs at that time. I recollect a group of us friends literally walking companies to companies with our physical resumes in hand, really seeking out for job opportunities. And we did not find any for the first almost 6-7 months, until very slowly each of us found some, you know, ways to get our first opportunities. So in a way, that was the first experience, and it kind of taught me the lesson of just staying there. You know, things will improve, things have to improve. You know, there's this famous adage, what goes down definitely has to come up. You know, if you are in a tunnel, you have to come out of a tunnel. There is no way, you know, there is no infinity there. You have to come out of it. When the sun sets, there will be a sunrise. When the moon decides to set, the moon decides to also rise. Happens to plants, right? When certain leaves dry and fall off, newer blooms happen. So nature itself is done that way. Nature itself is built and designed that way. So I think that was my very first lesson, just coming out of college and, you know, struggling for my first job. In fact, I tell my kids are grown up. I have a 21-year-old son who is just about to complete his engineering, and my daughter who's just got into college. I tell them, I think that's the best learner, that you should not find a job so easily, because then you won't understand what it is, what is the joy of really having a job, the joy of really having a career. So I tell, you know, sometimes it's good to go through those crisis points. You learn through everything. And what it taught me was not tools. It did not teach me tools. It did not teach me how should I, communicate. It did not teach me how should I create a team, or did not teach me how should I run my organization. But what all these crises that I have been through has really taught me is what should be my behaviors, you know, and what should be my mindset as I get into each of these crises. Today, you know, my colleagues keep joking at me, what Hema really likes is a set of problems. And that exactly it is. I enjoy problems around me. I enjoy issues around me, because it brings the innovation, it brings the best out of me, you know. So that's right. That's the reason I decided I'll choose on this topic, and maybe it'll also give you some tips on how you can look at your own careers. And I don't mean leaders as in those roles that people play in organization. Leadership is a behavior, you know, and if you are carrying your notebook, I want you to write this down. Leadership is not a role. Leadership is a behavior. You know, I was talking to this very young child. She's barely 15 years old. Her name is Vinisha Uma Shankar. And since I'm part of CII, we do several events there. And she is a girl who was born in a middle-class family, born and brought up in Tiruvannamalai, you know, suburban town, if you will. And you know, if you were to anticipate a middle-class girl born in a suburban town like Tiruvannamalai, you would anticipate somebody who probably does not have access to the right education, and therefore, you know, probably is not as exploratory and as innovative as she is. And she's a wonder. You know, she studies in Tiruvannamalai. Her English is impeccable. You know, the way, the language that she chooses, the words that she chooses to use are impeccable. And more importantly, her innovative mindset. So here's a 15-year-old girl who walks into her town and she sees these istriwalas, you know, who use the coal istris to iron the clothes, which even now in Chennai, it happens in many places. So she, with the help of her father, goes and creates a solar cart, a cart which is solar powered, which indirectly powers the istri, the ironing board, and helps these people not only save money on coal, but also save the environment, and also helps these people, you know, attract attention, because the carts were done in such a beautiful manner. And I was awestruck. I said, here is an example of leadership. She doesn't have a team, you know, she doesn't have people around her, but she's a leader in her own right. And today, of course, she is a winner of several innovation awards around her. So that's an example of a leader, right? So I'm not talking about leader as in role. I'm talking leaders as in a behavior, leader as a skill set within you. And how can you be one such leader? I'll give you another example. I have this friend's daughter of mine who did her engineering and then went ahead, got married, regular normal life, right? Gets into her new in-laws' home. And for various reasons, she was feeling very bored and she didn't like her job. So she decides to go for a holiday with her husband, and she had her first experience in scuba diving. She comes back home, she registers for a training in scuba diving, and today she's an expert mariner scuba diver, which means she goes deep into the waters and finds those plastic things, you know, things that hamper ecology, you know, marine ecology, and she is a preventer of those. She creates plans and programs to clean up riverbeds and lake beds from marine wastes, to help preserve the ecology. Now tell me, isn't that a leadership behavior? For me, it's a wonderful example of a leadership behavior. It's what the person wanted to do and goes about in doing it. So therefore, I think I'm setting my premise all for you for the next few minutes as we go through this. This is not about you becoming a leader with a team of people around you, but it is about you being a leader within yourself. And then as a leader within yourself, how do you go through this crisis situations that we are experiencing all by ourselves, right? So as I told you, I promised you some nice activities. So here's the first activity. What you do is go to this particular website mentioned here, pollev.com. /Lennox India T499. You click the whole thing, just type the whole thing, pollev.com/Lennox India T499. Okay, go to any browser. If you're using Apple, you can go to your Safari browser. If you're using Android, just go into your Google browser and just type out this pollev.com/Lennox India T499. And you will see this question. Just answer this question and hit the submit button. I'll give us a minute for us to see the responses. How do you feel today? It's a simple tester question. How do you feel today? Please go ahead. Praveena, if you're listening, just help out.
Please share the link in the chat box.
Okay. If pollev, it's here. It's right here. pollev.com/Lennox India T499. I think some students have got it. Those of you who have got it, just put that link on the chat so that all your other friends can gain access. If I escape this, then I will miss the seeing the response because it's going live. Those of you who have seen it, just type it and put it in your chat so that it helps others. Two responses. So somebody got up really bright, looking forward to the session. Somebody very scared as to what the session will be and what will be the outcome of the session. Some of you seem to have a good breakfast, so you're all full of glee and laughter. And some probably did not get their breakfast or probably just got up from their beds. All right, so how do you feel today? We'll give it a few more seconds. All right, superb. So a lot of you are answering that. Nice. So it's a good indicator for the faculty too, whether it is appropriate for you to have a lecture session as early as this morning, especially on a Monday, or do you want to do it on a Thursday evening or a Wednesday evening? You know, it's a good indicator. Nice. Give it a few more seconds and there's somebody really angry and also feeling wild, huh? So I'm going to be expecting some very wild questions from them. Somebody is quite upset. There's 8% of this population quite upset that we did this on a Monday. All right, great. So now that you had a feel, let's go to the real thing. This is your next question. What are your expectations from this session? What would you like me to cover or what would you like me to talk during this session? Don't need to put your name, just put your expectations from this session. What would you like me to talk? What would you like me to share during this session? Is everybody typing in? Because I can't see the responses. Yeah. What would you like me to cover during the session? Anybody trying? To gain more knowledge and courage in doing something independent. Wonderful. Very nice. That's somebody giving attendance. I don't need attendance. I'm asking, what are your expectations from this session? To gain knowledge, all right. All right, to gain knowledge. Let me ask you, what do you mean by gaining knowledge? What exact knowledge do you want from this session? What exact knowledge do you want from this session? To learn something new, all right. Leadership, fantastic. Somebody says, I want to learn about leadership. Gain more knowledge, learn something new, all right. Okay, anything else? That's 4 plus 7, 8, 9 people who have responded out of 200 odd people, I'm told. Leadership. Aishu, I don't need your presence here. Just type in your expectations from this session. Qualities to gain leadership in situations and lead. All right. Learn something new. All right. All right. So I think the general flavor is to know, just know something new, and then also to see in leadership, what more can I learn or what can I learn around leadership? I think that's what the flavor is all about. So we'll stop this here and move forward. Let's move forward. All right, so the first thing of being a leader, right, and here is something I'm talking about experiences and from experiences, is about organizing. How do you respond to crisis? Now, look this at in a family environment, right? I mean, there are crises that hit families too, right? There are family members that go through a lot of crisis. Sometimes it can be in extreme natures of losing a loved one. To very simple things like there is a financial problem, or there is a, you know, there is somebody in distress, or there's a theft that happened at home, let's imagine, or something like that, right? What is the first thing you do in the family? You try to organize around yourself. You try to understand, whom should I reach out to for help? Whom should I consult with? Who should assist me in this whole process, right? So you would probably see your fathers, your parents, or your moms, or your elder brothers or elder sisters do this. They're constantly trying to see who is the rapid response team. So my terminology here is, who is our rapid response team? Whom can we rely on, right? And this happens not only in homes, but also in organizations. And organizational crisis, don't think only COVID is the kind of crisis. There are other crises. For example, most of you might land up jobs in a bank, you know, and most of these banks today sell multiple financial products, right? They have insurance products that they are selling, there are mutual fund products that they're selling, and there are targets. When you don't make a monthly target, obviously you're in crisis because you're not going to make the money. So that's also a form of crisis. There can be daily crisis. For example, your final evaluation of money at the beginning and the end of the day may not match, and there could be some issue with the way the bookkeeping is done. Those are day-to-day crisis. So crisis can be anything. It can be very small to an extremely large form of crisis, like the one that we are today going through, the COVID crisis. It can be as magnitude as that, or it can be very small set of crisis. A strike that is happening in the neighborhood can affect a bank. That is a crisis. The bank employee is going on a strike. That is a crisis. So the first thing that you do there is, how do you organize yourself to respond in those crises? And here I'll give you an example. When we went through COVID at Lennox, where I work, about a year back, March 11th was when we got the first information that COVID is entered India. We had the first two cases in Delhi. And much before that, we operate also in China. So we had our colleagues in China already experienced this, and they were all home quarantined for a long period. I think right from Jan, they were home quarantined. And we were in the midst of March when several of our colleagues were traveling outside of India in several other locations. We had employees in Europe, we had employees traveling in US, and families were trying to reach us out saying, how is the company going to support? Because March 11th, if I remember, was the first international travel ban. All international flights were canceled as a first step to mitigate COVID in the nation. And our first crisis point at that time was a travel-related crisis, that we had to get back our employees back to home base in a safe and sound condition. And therefore, the first response team that we created was just the leadership team of different verticals, along with our travel team, along with our travel advisory team, and then trying to understand, how do we respond to these crises? How do we get people back home? And of course, you know, with a lot of deliberations and planning and coordination between teams in India, teams in Europe, and teams in US, we made sure employees were all brought back home. They were put in quarantine. If you remember those days, the moment you enter into India, you had to be put into a 14-day quarantine. We had to block hotels, make sure the quarantine was done. Families were informed on a day-to-day basis on how they are doing and making sure they were, sent back to their homes in a safe condition. So this was a kind of creating a response team. Now, the analogy is, even at homes, you probably do it. You know, when there is a small, let's say there's a theft that has happened, in your home or in your neighborhood. What happens? Immediately, there's a group of people coming together. There are some people who are decision makers. There's some people who know people, who know connections. They know the local policewala. They know the local judiciary. They're connectors. You need them also. Then there are some people who are willing to go and do certain things. You know, now, I'm going to go there, get that stamp paper. Let me go get this printed. So you have some people who are organizers. So you need all sorts of people to form your rapid response team. You need connectors, you need socializers, you need organizers, you need the executors, right? It's a network of teams. So the first thing that you may want to do is, as a leader, how do I build a very effective team around me? Second thing is, in the times of crisis, how do I organize them? And here is something that we did around that time. We created one called as a response leadership team. Now, what is a response leadership team? As a response leadership team, our whole agenda was to plan what we call in corporate terminology as business continuity planning. Now, this is a jargon, right? Now, but what essentially this team was doing is trying to look at the various aspects of the organization and seeing where all the impact could be. So number one, we got our employees home. But two, work had to continue. We were all working in the offices. How do we make sure this work was shifted to homes? Then we needed an IT team, an IT project management team, what we called as a network project management team. There were employees or families who were afraid because this pandemic was completely new. We did not know the wholeness of this disease. There was a lot of panic in the air. So we needed a response team, which took care of insurance, hospitalization, making sure communications are being sent out to employees on a regular basis, or a medical advisory team, sorry. Then we needed a response team, the team that completely focused on communication and different levels of communication via internet, via meetings, via all employee town hall meetings like the one we are right now having via one-on-one calls with employees, wherever employees were very, very, very affected. So this was a response leadership team that we created. What this team did was take a decision and then communicate it to the different aspects, which are called as the action team that you see on the right side. We had created different teams there. We had a technology team which focused on making sure people who are working on desktops had laptops at home. It's not just laptops. People needed a very sturdy Wi-Fi connection at home, so providing them Wi-Fi dongles. After some time, we thought of HomeKit allowance and all of that happened. Then there was a whole real estate space, right? The office had to be decontaminated, desanitized, and kept in a state where even if people want to go to the office and work, they should feel safe about it. So making sure sanitization facilities were created in the office, a colleague outreach, you know, wherever employees were in distress, reaching them out and communicating with them and constantly being in touch with them. Financial implications, because we were at a point where we were spending a lot on just shifting work from offices to work. So what are the financial implications? What are the external communications that we were sending out to people around us? And a supply chain, how did that impact and how did that affect? Now, this is called creating and organizing a team in crisis. If you look at it, you do this even in families. You know, there's somebody who does something and they are the ones that who work on creating such kind of organization teams. The second important thing during a crisis is, this is a very, very important thing, and I can't undermine the importance of this, the value of deliberate calm and bounded optimism. It's a very, very, very important feature or a behavior or a mindset of a leader. And I have learned this through all the four crises that I have experienced. As a leader, you know, you would see this, you know, in families where your parents are taking decision, you would see the best decision are taken by parents who are in a certain state of calmness and there is an optimism. This too shall pass should be the mantra at that point. And as a leader, it is important to bear that kind of personality and that kind of calmness around you, because you have not only your employees, but their family is looking up to you. And they want to feel the confidence. So for example, in Lennox, we used to have our CEO who used to meet us up maybe once a year in a town hall, suddenly meeting us over WebEx or, you know, Teams meeting almost once every couple of months, assuring us that things are going to get well. And we as an organization are doing the right things to make sure things are getting well. And you can't even believe the magic that it happened on families. Families started thanking us, saying we feel so secure to be in a company like this, that our son is in a company like this, or our daughter-in-law is in a company like this. That is called having a deliberate calm and unbounded optimism. Now, how do you acquire this? It comes through what I call as mindfulness. You should enjoy getting into a situation. You should enjoy getting problems in your hand. Now, how do you do that? It comes with a certain amount of self-confidence. How do you get self-confidence? When you start putting yourself into such situations. How do you put yourself into such situations? Tomorrow, when you all find your first job and your manager comes and tells you, oh, you have to go to this new area and create this new branch, at that point, that is the point where you make that deflection. If you say no, you're missing out an opportunity. If you say yes, you're straight away walking into your first challenge. And when you come out with a sense of self-confidence. So it's that first step that you take. Do you say yes to things that are unpredictable in nature, are challenging in nature? And will you walk into that challenge? Because when you come out of it, you gain self-confidence. You start liking challenges. You start liking issues and start looking out to solve issues. So this is a very important thing which I would like you to note down, the value of deliberate calm and bounded optimism. The third thing is, Praveena, how much time do I have? We are at 12:10. I just want to be aware of time. The third important thing is making decisions amid uncertainty, right? Leadership is always about making decisions. Now, I told you about the story of this little girl, Vinisha, who went and created an iron cart with solar-powered cells. Now, did she have all materials around her to create that cart? No. Did she know how she will solve the problem? No. But what that did was that uncertainty made her go and research, made her and her father go and read up materials, go see some samples around different things, and then they make decisions. So decision making is a very important skill, and I'm sure you would have learned that enough in your management sciences. But more important is making decisions amidst uncertainty. Can you make a decision in crisis? Because that's when the heart rate increases, your mind stops working. But at that point, can you exercise calm? And can you slowly start resurging your brain to make those decisions for you? Can you pause? So the important word in this slide is pause to assess and anticipate and then act, right? There is a lot of value in stillness. There's a lot of value in just quieting down your mind for a while, thinking through the whole situation and coming out with decisions. And I've seen this in all my four experiences of the major crisis. I've seen this, how it really works magic. It's magical to see how that little bit of stillness, that little bit of pause to assess and anticipate enhances the quality of your decisions and makes your decision all the more powerful. I don't know if you've noticed this. You see leaders, I mean, especially in down south, and of course, he's very revered. Dr. Kalam was a heavily revered man. Have you watched him when he is with people? Have you watched him on videos when he is listening to people? You would see he's paying complete attention. That is the stillness. He's paying complete attention. That is stillness. What is that stillness doing to him? It is giving him a set of data points to work on at the back of his mind. And then he goes and creates amazing kind of work that is happening and which we now know is historical. The kind of launches that we've experienced during his leadership, etc., etc. That is called stillness. And it's very important to build on that stillness, build on that pause to assess and anticipate. How many of you here who organize college fests and, you know, your fests, when you have to take decisions and when there's uncertainty, what is it that you do? You start running around, you start fretting, you start complaining, you start blaming each other, saying, "Avan apdi pannina, ivan apdi." So that is not decision making during uncertainty. At the same time, you may look at another child who says, who's experiencing the same uncertainty, just standing there evaluating and then saying, "Okay, let's do this. Step number one, step number two, step number three," right? That is making decisions amidst uncertainty and a very important skill. And the key skill there is pause to assess and anticipate. Fourth one is demonstrating empathy. Right now, as leaders, you may be close to the crisis situation, but your other colleagues may not be. They may not even understand what is happening. Their families are even more disturbed. They're so much afraid. There's so much of fear. Of course, COVID has amplified it, but there were other crises also that we went through, the economic crisis, the housing, you know, collapse that we had, the financial crisis that we all experienced, the Wall Street, the major New York bombing incident that happened. All of this taught us that as leaders, one should first of all demonstrate empathy. There is a beautiful video if you would all like to take a look at. This is by, it's a TEDx talk. It's on YouTube. There is this federal hospital surgeon who has just come home the previous night of the major crash of the Twin Towers. He's just come home and, you know, he has no clue that a flight has hit the Twin Tower. So he comes home and a friend of his calls and tells him that there's a plane that's entered the Twin Tower, and he thinks it's a minor incident and, you know, he just brushes it off. After an hour or so, he hears sniffling voices from the living room where his family is. And then he goes and he sees the entire family, his three children, his wife, staring at the TV screen and literally sobbing away as they're seeing the Twin Towers fall off. Now, for this doctor, he's just come from a previous night clinical work. So obviously, doctors are extremely tired. So he has no clue. He enters his living room and this is what he experiences. Twin Tower is falling down. His family is sobbing. What does he do? You know, what would you do in such a situation? You and I probably would sit there staring at that TV screen along with your family and sympathize. Oh, so sad this has happened. You would cry because it's happening in your city. You would be afraid because it's happening in your neighborhood. What he does, he instantly takes his pager, buzzes 150 of his colleagues who were all working with him the previous night. And he calls them all and says, we have to be quick in action. He goes out to the fire brigade, accumulates about 200, 300 fire, those vans where these federal hospices, these are called federal hospices. They're doctors predominantly working for the government. They all get into these vans. They rush into the spot. And he sees that the magnanimity of the damage is far more than what he really saw on TV. So what he does there, while he is giving directions to his team where to enter, where to exit, what to do, he is also, on the other hand, pulled out one of his team member and made him in charge of calling each of the family members of those 150 colleagues who are with him and tell them what is happening, where their spouses are or their brothers or their sons are, and keep them informed on a time-to-time basis what is happening. Isn't this a great example of empathy in crisis? And that is... And just imagine coming out of it, we're very fortunate. He unfortunately lost quite a few of his colleagues. He lost, I think, about 30 or 40 of his colleagues. But the remaining of them stood by with him. And he says that that's been such a powerful lesson of empathetic leadership for him. So deal with the tragedy first and accept it and bring everybody into it. Similarly, here in Lennox, what we did, as I told you, there was a response team. Each one of us were connected to a group of employees. And our only deal for the first half of the day was to talk to each employee, make sure that they and their families were doing fine and things were taken care of them. If we had an unfortunate incident of a colleague experiencing COVID in the family, we would make sure we are calling them every day, make sure, they have grocery support or, medicinal support, or if they needed hospital support. That is empathy in leadership. It's about dealing with human tragedy first, because people want that, right? So I just pulled this out, right? A crisis is when it is most important for leaders to uphold a vital aspect of their role. The most important aspect of their role for me, actually, making a positive difference in people's lives. Doing this requires leaders to acknowledge the personal and professional challenges that employees and their loved ones experience during a crisis. Nothing more important, right? Because if the families are not taken care of, guess what? The employee is not taken care of. If the employee is not taken care of, then how do you anticipate work to be done well? How do you anticipate them to be contributing well at their work, right? So it's all about how are you upholding that vital aspect of making positive difference in people's lives. And that's the commitment I want each of you youngsters to build in. Tomorrow, as you step out, become leaders of yourself and, into organizations, make that one personal promise for yourself that you will make a positive difference in people's lives in whatever role you do, in whatever small or big role that you do, you will bring about a positive difference in their lives. So that brings me to the next one. Now, to build all this empathy, to build all this trust, one of the important parameters is communicating effectively. There has to be various ways to communicate and reach out to people. You know, I'm all about people engagement. So for me, it's not just one-on-ones. I chat with them. I'm on WhatsApp with them. I do town halls with them. I am always communicating. And communicating is both ways. It's not just not me giving my gyan, but 80% of the time, I'm just listening to them. I'm just absorbing what they're saying and what they're telling, what their feedback for us is. It's very important, at such, especially during a time of crisis, that you maintain transparency and provide frequent updates. And here is where friends, culturally in India, we are not tuned to this so much. Usually, you know, we've seen when parents go through crisis, they don't share much with the children because they want the children to feel protected. And therefore, there's a little shroud, you know, there's an opaqueness of what is happening. You know, I know Amma and Appa are going through something, but they're not telling us. And that's making me feel agitated, insecure, fearsome. But the most effective way to deal with a crisis is to bring it out in the open, share it with people, lay it the way it is, maintain transparency, and provide frequent updates. It works extremely well, because who knows, the best ideas come from a place where you least expect it. And we've sensed it too. You know, a lot of decisions we've had to make during this COVID pandemic, we just put it out all there on the table. This is a problem we are facing and we don't know how to solve it. And lo and behold, there would be an intern sitting who just joined us 2 months back who would give us an idea. And, you know, we would work on that idea and that idea turned out to be very powerful. Now, these are all examples of how you leverage community. It's about leveraging community, because the leader should not be a person. You should not be a person saying, I know it all. Then you know very less, right? The power is in everybody. The power is to be equally distributed, because some best ideas come from the furthest corners of the organization. So how do you leverage it and how do you cultivate that into your organization and build it as part of your supply chain, you know, of ideas and of communication? Here, I want to talk to you a little about trust, right? Now, communicating is also about building trust, right? Now, how do you build trust? It's a very important aspect for a leader. And I have a beautiful equation for it, which you can write down if you will. Trust for me is credibility plus reliability. It's an equation, okay? Credibility plus reliability divided by self-orientation. Okay? Now, what are these words? What is credibility? Credibility is what I do, whatever I do. Right now, I'm giving you this talk, all right? Or professionally, I'm in HR, I'm a leader. So what I do, right? That's credibility. Second one I said is reliability. Credibility plus reliability. Reliability is how well do I do that, right? Does she communicate this effectively every time? Then I tend to trust her. She does it occasionally, then I don't trust her much. She's one of those who does it occasionally. I don't trust her much, right? But if I do it consistently, you'll start trusting me. So credibility plus reliability divided by self-orientation. What is self-orientation? Am I doing this for myself or am I doing this for your benefit? So the moment this talk is all about me talking about my success stories, you will trust me lesser. But the moment you see me that I'm giving this address for your benefit, I'm giving you the tools and the skill sets, and I'm giving you the helping hand, you start trusting me more. All right. So it's a beautiful equation. I love to use this equation. So you can write it down. Credibility plus reliability divided by self-orientation. So self-orientation is high, trust is low. If self-building is higher. So it's a beautiful equation and it really adds value to the way we communicate in teams. Let's see next. All right, so we are coming close to the session. I think I have about 10 minutes and I can take in questions, Praveena, and build on the questions. That was my last slide. Any questions? People can ask questions.
Thank you, ma'am. I now request the girls to put in your questions in the chat box, please.
And how can I see it? It comes on the private chat, is it?
Ma'am, it's on the comments section, ma'am. It's right next to the private chat.
Okay, comments. Okay. All right. Okay, so far no questions. Any question? It can be on anything, any subject. How long will it take to build trust, ma'am, based on your experience? A good question. It does take a while. I'll be very honest. It does take a while. Initially, when you join the organization, it's like when you join the college, right? Teachers also don't trust us immediately. It takes some time for them to build trust. I can't give a timeline. Sometimes trust gets built really fast. If you're given your first assignment when you join a job and you do it really well, you can see the first points of trust bank building, and then you just have to keep building on it. But let's say your first assignment, for certain reasons goes wrong, then, you know, the trust factor builds more slowly because now they are starting to gauge you and start thinking twice whether to give you the next such similar assignment. So it's really directly proportionate to how successfully you do your first job or your first assignment. I hope that helps you, Darshu. Good afternoon. Ma'am, can you explain that formula again? Yeah, you can take that down. Maybe I'll write it down here and you can. Let me create another slide. Let's do this. Trust formula is credibility plus reliability divided by self-orientation. Yeah. So what is credibility? It is how well I do my job, right? How I do my job. And reliability is how well and consistently do I do my job? Self-orientation is, do I do it for my benefit or for the team? Okay, did you get that? All right, so there you go. Did you get that? All right. Any other questions? We are about 12:28 now. Thank you. Looks like there are no questions. I have just one more slide. Again, back to your poll. Take your polling thing, and I would like you to rate this. How would you rate this session? Again, same poll, ev.com/LenexIndiaT499. And you can just give me your rating on how you found this session. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So, Praveena, over to you. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful session. Thank you for teaching us how to remain calm and optimistic right after a crisis. And we are sure we'll realize that we're all diamonds in the rough. Now I call upon Sai Pooja, Joint Association Secretary of the Department of Bank Management, to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Neha.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me first start by giving glory to the Almighty God for making today's session a resounding success. I thank our chief guest and speaker for the day, Ms. Hema Mani, Director HR for India and APAC, Lenin International, for sharing her wisdom on the topic, Leadership in Uncertain Times. This session was not only insightful and motivating, but it was also very interactive. I'm sure, ma'am, our students will create a new path for themselves and be a leader, creating an own identity for themselves. I'm thankful for the unstinted support given by Dr. Mrs. Kodai, Principal and Secretary, Ethraj College for Women, and Dr. Mrs. D.B. Usharani, Vice Principal, Aided Ethraj College for Women. I thank Dr. Mrs. T. Usha Priya, ma'am, Vice Principal, self-supporting, and head of the Department of Bank Management, for her able guidance and continued support. I owe special gratitude to Mrs. Praveena Ma'am for organizing this exceptional session. My heartfelt thanks to the faculty members of Department of Bank Management for their valuable contribution and encouragement in all our efforts. This department acknowledges with profound love and affection the contribution of Dr. Mrs. Kausalya Murthy and Justice M.N. Murthy. Last but not the least, I thank students for joining this insightful session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sai. Thank you.